Alright, everybody, here we are for the Monday Night Raw review from September 9th, 2013. We kick off the show with the returning Edge, the rated R, a superstar, or superstar, as Tony Schimmel would say. And it was awesome to hear him just do the announcing for Edge. That was beautiful. So he gets a great reaction, obviously. We're in Toronto, Canada. No surprise here that Edge gets an enormous pop. Great reaction, and it was a cool return. He comes in and does the cutting Edge. He says the reason why he's back is because Triple H wanted him here, best for business, whatever. And his guest is supposed to be Randy Orton, but he isn't going to do that because he wants Daniel Bryan to be his guest because that's what the fans want, and he believes that's what's best for business. So the crowd absolutely goes nuts over Daniel Bryan's entrance, and they're all behind Bryan. This was an amazing, amazing couple of reactions here. The crowd was very good tonight, very, very good, or last night. Edge basically, you know, asks Bryan if he can beat Orton and win back the championship, and Bryan, of course, is yelling yes. But of course, Randy Orton comes out, interrupts, and says that only a place like Canada gives a crap about Randy Orton. About Edge, not himself. He would never say that. He thinks everybody cares about Randy Orton. But no, he says that only here do they give a shit about Edge, blah, blah, blah. But then, of course, Edge goes on to call him a puppet to Triple H and starts talking crap about how Triple H doesn't know talent. Of course, the game comes out and says, "Say it to my face, suck it." And so Edge, of course, says, "Well, I'm not employed here, so I can say whatever the hell I want. I don't have to bite my tongue. I'm just going to say what's on my mind." And of course, he does. So he goes off on Triple H saying that, you know, you thought Jericho couldn't make it, you thought Edge couldn't make it, you even thought John Cena couldn't make it, and they all have been successful. And now you think Daniel Bryan can't make it, and you're wrong once again. And Triple H says, "Yes, I've been wrong before, but I'm also right sometimes. And the biggest time I was right was when I talked about you being a failure, Edge. That entire time, you couldn't draw even a dime." Obviously, this gets plenty of heat on Triple H. And then it all ends up going back and forth with insults until Triple H says, "Well, we can't hurt you, so we're going to hurt the one that you love." And they bring out a dilapidated-looking Christian. The Shield had beaten the fuck out of him backstage, and Edge yells for them for some help. We come back from commercial, and of course, Edge and Triple H are talking. The Shield is kind of the barrier between the two of them, and Edge says he wishes the doctors were clear and so they could fight, and I'm like, "Oh, I wish too." One more match for Edge would be amazing. That would just be astronomically great. This was a really good opening segment. You know, you bring back Edge to get somebody else involved into this storyline, a fresh face involved in this big storyline, and a good perspective on it. I thought this was a really good opener with a nice promo, and this was good. This was a good 20 minutes of television. This is what is best for business, because you're bringing back a great legend. That's going to make people tune in automatically. You just kick the show off in a hot way. I thought this was awesome. Very, very good opening. Does it really do a million things for Daniel Bryan versus Randy Orton? Maybe not a whole lot, but it still does build up the main angle, and it gets you to understand the depth of the corporation, and again, an outsider's perspective. Edge even saying he wishes he could come out, teasing an Edge return, even though we know it's not going to happen. That would be amazing. I just thought this whole thing as a whole was just entertaining television that still revolved around the corporation angle, so it was still a good thing. Kofi Kingston versus Curtis Axel was the first matchup. Ends up in a disqualification when Axel keeps continuous knees on Kofi into the corner, wouldn't stop. Kofi gets the victory via DQ, and then, of course, Axel keeps beating down on Kofi while Paul's saying, "This better not happen on Sunday," because then, of course, he's going to have to face CM Punk, and then Kofi ends up hitting Trouble in Paradise and getting over a little bit. Please, dear Lord, don't tell me that Kofi Kingston is going to have to face Curtis Axel for the IC belt and then potentially win the belt again. Please, dear God, don't tell me that Kofi Kingston is going to win the IC title again, because that would just be terrible. Not another IC title run, please. Kofi needs something different. Either way, Paul doesn't have any faith in Axel here, so he pretends to slip on some water and then subsequently injure his knee. So he obviously comes out to the ring and is on his crutches, and he needs to be checked out by his personal doctor. He doesn't want the WWE doctors or the Canadian doctors or anybody else. He wants his own personal physician to check him out, and that's the only way that he's going to have an examination. Brad Maddox comes out. Of course, the Maddox is the overseer, the voice of reason here in this situation. Of course, the Maddox always knows best. The Maddox comes out. He says, you can't go on your own personal physician's word. We have to get Dr. Samson to check you out. So they roll up the pant leg, and he's examining the knee, and he says, well, he's clearly fine. And then, so Heyman goes nuts, and the Maddox says, well, since you're clearly fine, you're not going to be able to get out of your match as you so wished. So you're going to be competing on Sunday at Night of Champions. Correct move by Maddox. Of course, CM Punk comes out with kendo stick in hand, beats the absolute fuck out of the personal physician of Heyman, and gets over with the crowd. A great reaction for Punk. Might not have been the greatest build-up segment of all time, but it still does its job. Heyman tries to get out of the match. Why does that make sense? Well, let's think about it. Heyman's a manager. Why the hell would he want to face CM Punk? CM Punk's already angry at him. This made perfect sense. Good little entertaining segment. He doesn't have a lot of faith in Axel. He's scared out of his mind. Punk comes out, scares him again. He runs away just fine. That was funny. And it was good. It was good stuff. Good television. A way to build up the match that may not have been the, oh my God, that was the greatest build-up of all time. But does that matter? It doesn't have to be amazing build-up. It wasn't. But it was good. It was entertaining. And it was nice. I'm happy with that. So we get Dolph Ziggler and Bray Wyatt. Wyatt goes over. So you know Ziggler is really, you know, in the doldrums right now, because he goes from world champion to losing to Bray Wyatt. But let me look at the positive side of this. Him losing to Bray Wyatt is a good thing, because you're pushing Bray Wyatt. You're trying to push Bray Wyatt as a big name, right? Well, if he beats a former world champion, then he's doing something good. This is good for Bray Wyatt. Yes, it sucks to see Ziggler keep losing matches, but let's not call him a jobber here for losing to Bray Wyatt. But because if Bray Wyatt loses, then everybody says, why the hell would Wyatt lose? You know, exactly. So it's a big win for Bray Wyatt, and it was a solid match. I actually wanted it to keep going. Yeah, I thought I could have gotten a few more minutes out of it. Ziggler is good as a face here, and I like Ziggler as a face. I've enjoyed his matches more with him as a face because he's easy to get behind, because his wrestling is good, because he looks like a babyface, for crying out loud. So they have him in a better spot now. They need to make sure he doesn't get too far down and all of a sudden is a mid-carder again like before. That's my fear, that they're going to tear him down only to build him back up, or just he'll never win another world title, which is a huge shame. But either way, this was a solid match. Throughout the night, we had retrospectives of Goldust's career, because he's returning tonight to face Randy Orton to potentially get Cody Rhodes back on the WWE main roster. Goldust has an opportunity of a lifetime here. They show retrospectives throughout his career, some of the cool things he's done, the funny tag team moments with Booker T, him, of course, dressing up as various characters, him being out of his fucking mind. Goldust is fucking hilarious, was always great. Dustin Rhodes. So Booker T pumps up Big Show. Last couple of weeks, we've seen Booker T backstage. I guess they're giving Booker a little bit of television time. Last week, he says Daniel Bryan needs to be careful because of the whole, the way he's been rebelling against the corporation. And then, of course, he tells Big Show that he's being professional and that he's doing the right thing because he needs to keep his job for the greater good. I don't know if Booker T's just trying to act as a voice of reason, trying to just make sure he doesn't get in any hot water himself, or if he's going to have any association with the corporation. I don't think any of that. I really just think he's kind of being, like, if anything, he's just kind of being a guy backstage that's kind of, you know, taking, not taking the corporation's side, but seeing the bigger picture, I guess. He's trying to be that guy. I think they really just don't have much else to do with Booker either, so, since he's no longer GM. Which was a debate. That wasn't even good anyway. He should just be a fucking commentator on SmackDown. Let JBL be the Raw commentator with Cole, and then let Booker T, or have JBL and Booker T on SmackDown. That'd be a very interesting trio on SmackDown there. Anyway, moving forward. So we get six Diva tag match. Natalya, Naomi, and Brie. The Total Divas cast take on Layla, Oksana, and Alicia Fox, and baby faces go over real easy here. Apparently, Layla, Oksana, and Alicia are kind of like the minions for AJ Lee, who's on commentary during this match. Fatal 4-Way set for Night of Champions, Natalya, Naomi, and Brie versus AJ Lee. I would imagine the heel Divas are going to interfere at some point during that match and help AJ Lee retain her title. This was really no surprise, pretty simple, but it was something at least to build up. Not really as much build up the Divas title match, but build up the Divas feud, the total Divas versus the anti-Divas kind of idea. Even though there's only one real anti-Diva, and she's not quite up on the main roster yet. But, you know, you figure you got 3-on-3 here. This wasn't really a great match dynamic by any means, but either way, at least you're getting something out of the Divas every week now. And Total Divas has done nothing but gotten good ratings, and it's helped the product a little bit, if anything, too. So I really have no true problems with that. R-Truth takes on Alberto Del Rio in a one-on-one match. Del Rio goes over. R-Truth, no shocker there. A heel victory for Del Rio. Yippee. I mean, it's RVD was shown in a little picture-in-picture before the match. Nothing else as far as interference, but we got more build-up to this world title match later. This wasn't really to build up the world title, but more just to build up Del Rio as champion. By the way, those rumors you hear of R-Truth getting a push, I don't think they're going to necessarily come true, and if anything, maybe one more mid-card title run. I don't see much else. So Antonio Cesaro takes on the returning Santino Marella, who got over pretty well in his native land. And Antonio Cesaro did an amazing spin during this match, a wonderful, wonderful spin that lasted for a good minute or more and was absolutely ridiculous. I will say this was just fantastic and an amazing sign of strength here. Just pure strength from Cesaro. He is unbelievable and just goes to show you how almost inhuman he is. And he got a holy shit chant off of doing a spin. Now that's ridiculous. But Marella ends up, of course, getting the quick victory with a roll up. And but Real Americans are going nowhere for now. Hopefully they get a push down the line. Santino winning is whatever. It was an entertaining, I'll give it this, for a pretty pointless match, this was actually fairly entertaining, I'm not gonna lie. It was one of the more entertaining matches of the day. Sandow and Miz, Sandow goes over fairly quickly, not really a big match. At least Sandow gets a TV win, I'll give it that. Fandango was the interruption that cost Miz the match, so you're building up Fandango and Miz, as well as getting the Money in the Bank briefcase winner a win. Very necessary when you consider this small little tidbit. Who the hell is Damian Sandow going to have a match with at Night of Champions? Well, that's a great question because I have no idea. And neither does anybody else, right? Damian Sandow, who the hell is he wrestling? I don't know. Great question. He's your Money in the Bank winner, yet he's lost every single match except this one, and this was not like a big victory or anything. So it's really annoying to see Sandow really be put in such a crappy spot. I mean, I like having the whole Rhodes versus Corporation feud, whatever, that's cool, but they kind of interrupted the Sandow-Rhodes feud. Now they can't continue that one on, which sucks because I thought that was going to continue on to Night of Champions, maybe with the briefcase on the line. Either way, I was pretty satisfied with Sandow getting at least a TV victory. Not that satisfied, trust me. So after this, we have a Goldust interview where he talks about being a screw-up, how he's always messed up all his opportunities, but he's not cool with his brother getting fired. And he is going to get his job done tonight, and he is going to avenge the loss that his family has received here. Triple H, you know, gives him the sarcastic, like, I hope you do get the job done. There's a lot of pressure on you. And so, there's a good pre-match interview where you at least get a feel of where Goldust is at in his head. So then we get the match, Orton and Goldust. And this was a really good match. It told a really good emotional story. And this is why this match was good. The in-ring action was good. It got plenty of time, and Goldust looked very good for a guy that hadn't wrestled in quite a while on WWE television. Put on a nice match, did what he had to do, even hit the crossroads on Orton, which was very cool. I thought that was a good spot there. And Goldust was great, and the crowd was real hot into this match, and Orton goes over with the RKO, yes, of course. And then, of course, you see the distraught Goldust after walking backstage, looking so disjointed and just terrible. He just looks so disappointed, and Stephanie, you know, of course, rubs it in his face real bad, just makes it seem that much worse. So you really got the emotional feel before the match, with the interview, during the match, with the great action and the near falls, and then eventually him, of course, not just coming up short, Orton getting over, and then afterwards the walk of shame, I guess you could say, and Stephanie just rubbing it in his face. I thought all of that put together as a segment was just amazing. I really enjoyed the match a lot. I like the emotional feel of it. I like the tie to Cody Rhodes that this had. I like that he was fighting for his brother and fighting against the corporation. It was good. It was flat out good stuff. I enjoyed it a lot. And again, like I said, this television, as far as the television match, it was quite good. So again, I was very satisfied with that. Next matchup was Rob Van Dam and Ryback. Mr. I have no place whatsoever. RVD ends up going over with a DQ, when Ryback puts RVD's, like, he, like, whacks him into the ring post balls first. That must have sucked. But, yeah, so the stupid finish, Ryback ends up hitting the shell shock, but before the match, Del Rio came out on the stage and says that RVD's washed up and that Ricardo was nothing without him. That at Night of Champions, they will be cheering ADR, not RVD. Whatever, at least it's a little bit of build-up. A lot of people, myself included, think that Ricardo could ultimately be turning on RVD at Night of Champions to help Del Rio retain the championship and get back and get back in his good graces, and Del Rio accepts Ricardo and they're back to where we were before. Because let's be honest here, Ricardo Rodriguez managing RVD makes basically no sense. I don't think RVD's winning the belt at Night of Champions. I think Del Rio will retain. But prediction, full predictions video will come out Friday/Saturday, so look to that. And I actually will do a predictions video this time. So Stephanie talks to Big Show, saying that you can be in Bryan's corner tonight, because that was established, that main event is going to be Daniel Bryan versus Dean Ambrose. Big Show is allowed to be in Bryan's corner, but he can't touch the Shield. Big Show is not allowed to do that. He's just going to sit at ringside. So Big Show picks up a TV and destroys it. It was an old TV anyway. So Daniel Bryan and Dean Ambrose is your main event. I've seen these guys wrestle in the indies as Bryan Danielson and Jon Moxley. So I have seen these guys wrestle before, many times. This was another really good match between these two guys. They even got a "This is awesome" chant from the crowd, as it deserved. There were some really nice spots in this match. Some great sells by Ambrose. Good back and forth action. And of course, Bryan carried the majority of the load. But this was a good match. And ends up ending in a good way, where Reigns tries to spear Bryan, misses. Rollins tries to get him with an aerial attack, misses. And then Ambrose ends up hitting him from behind, but ends up with a quick roll-up that Bryan gets the victory. I was hoping for a different kind of finish, but still, it was a victory for Bryan, and also gets Bryan over the Shield, and he outsmarts the three of them. They all end up attacking him, and Orton comes out. Well, he suicide dives Orton, and then the Shield end up ambushing him, then Orton ends up RKOing him in the ring, and Triple H comes out and says, "I want you, Big Show. I want you to knock out Bryan again." And so Big Show gets back in the ring. Of course, he's having the same struggle as last time. Orton's yelling in his face saying, "You gotta do this. If Triple H said it, if I say it, you have to do it." And so he's getting ready to do it. And then Orton's, you know, picks up Bryan and he just stops. He can't do it. He drops Bryan and comes back over and tries to get him to do it again. And then he goes to pick Bryan back up, but Bryan comes at him with a running knee and knocks him down and hoists the WWE title. To go over. So everybody that's worrying about Daniel Bryan never getting any kind of revenge at all, well, what do you got to say now? I mean, again, like I said, it was only a couple of weeks. You're trying to establish the angle. When you're trying to establish a big heel faction like that, you want them to get over as much as they can. Because if they didn't get over enough, those same people that say, "Oh, Bryan's not getting revenge," would say, "Oh, well, how am I supposed to take the corporation seriously if they never get over?" Well, exactly. When you have a new heel stable like that, they're supposed to get over. And Daniel Bryan finally got one over on them this week on the go-home show, going into the pay-per-view looking like he has a good, solid chance of potentially overcoming the Shield. He showed that he can outsmart the Shield. He showed that he can beat down Orton. He showed that he can come out on top. And so that was a great way to end the show. It was a great main event. And again, you built up to your WWE Championship match, and that was good. Now, having the Shield just kind of disappear, like, not really doing much else after that. Triple H apparently just going back to the backstage. I know they didn't do anything else, but whatever. I don't really care that much about that. That's not really the point. The point is Bryan did get one over on Orton and the corporation by hoisting up the title and ending the show with the momentum. So that was good. As far as the overall for this show goes tonight, I think there were some really big positives to take away, but there were also some draggy spots. Let's first say this. Great positive. Edge coming back, having a promo, getting involved in the corporation angle. It was good stuff, a great promo, entertaining television, built up the main event angle as well as built up the whole corporation thing with an outside source like Edge. Really good stuff there. The Goldust segment was amazing. I love the interview beforehand and his walk of shame afterwards to add to the emotional spectrum, as well as the video packages shown throughout the night. The match itself was real good, had an emotional edge to it, just as the Cody Rhodes match did the week before. Good stuff, liking the angle. It's a really good television stuff. It might have just seemed like some whatever kind of mid-card stuff that it's actually becoming one of the best parts of the show over the last couple of weeks. As far as the Heyman Punk thing, that was built up in some way, shape, or form. It was built up in an entertaining way with Heyman faking the injury, trying to get out of the match for Sunday, and then getting checked out. He's faking the injury, Punk coming out, getting over one over on the doctor with the kendo stick shots. That's always entertainment to the fans. It makes you look forward to their match on Sunday when he can maybe get his hands on him, and then maybe pull the swerve by having some other Heyman guy be revealed or something like that. As far as the main event goes, it was a great match between a member of the Shield and Daniel Bryan, of course, that member being Dean Ambrose. It was a really good match. Again, Bryan gets one over, which was much needed once again. And I really enjoyed that. Now, as far as the overall card for Night of Champions, how it's looking, how it's shaping up, I think it looks pretty good. I mean, Orton versus Bryan will be the big interesting match. As far as the World Heavyweight title goes, I think RVD and ADR will be a good match, and I think Ricardo will be the big X factor. Will he turn? Will he not? Whatever. Divas were built up at least a little bit. I'll give it that. Not like it was in a great way. And then you had your filler matches. You know, you had Truth and Del Rio and Cesaro and Santino and Sandow and Miz. And, there was some dips in the show. Kofi and Axel even was like, whatever. And Ziggler and Wyatt was pretty good, though. Overall, this show was like C+, B- worthy to me again. I'm going to go C+ this week. I think this was a decent show that had some pretty big positives, but not a million of them. Whereas there weren't a hell of a lot of negatives, but the show kind of dragged a little bit. And they're going to have a pre-show match at Night of Champions with tag teams, which is good. But I would have liked to have seen those tag teams get a little bit of exposure, maybe the PTPers or one of those teams, which I imagine they're going to go over. It's the number one contenders tag match. That's a good thing to have for your pre-show and get your tag teams involved. Wouldn't have minded seeing a little more of that than just the Real Americans lose to Santino Marella. Just saying. I would have minded seeing them versus PTP once more and maybe them end up getting over. They got over on the Usos on SmackDown. Wouldn't have minded seeing the Real Americans pick up a couple of victories to start looking a little more strong than they have been, which is not at all terrible. They've looked terrible lately, to be honest. Overall, though, this was like a C+ show to me. This was good. A solid Raw. Not an amazing Raw, but a solid Raw. And continued on some good angles, had a couple of nice matches. As far as build-up to the show goes, you know, you have your world title, you have your WWE title, you have the Heyman Punk match. But as far as, like, you know, the U.S. title and the tag belts and stuff like that, it's like, you know, it's kind of lacking a little bit. Divas are just, you know, usual. But they're better than they were before, so again, it's a step up from what we had seen before. As far as overall, I think this will be the Night of Champions will be pretty solid. I think it'll be okay. I'm not thinking it's going to be anywhere near as good as SummerSlam, but I think it'll be a decent show. Either way, though, I thought this Raw was entertaining, and overall, I'm going to give it a C+. It was a solid show, but again, you know, dragged at times through the second hour mainly. A little too many matches, maybe, or too many matches didn't really have an amazing amount of things to do with anything, but as far as the main angles go, they were built up fairly well, and this was an alright show, so C+ works for me. Let me know what you guys thought of this week's Raw down in the comment section below, as well as being sure to hit the like button and subscribing up above for more to come. Impact review I am planning on doing this week, because it's the No Surrender show. I'm sorry for not doing one last week, I didn't have time. And it wasn't very good. So, no, I wasn't really going to say too many good things anyway. And then Friday or Saturday, I'll have the Night of Champions predictions. And Sunday night, of course, the review. I apologize for this review being up a day late, but shit happens. Planning to do the Q&A video next week. So be sure to add your questions. Now, I got 15 questions so far, which I'm very happy with. Thank you to everybody. But I'd like to get between 20 and 25 overall. But I always say 15 to 25 is the range I like. So we have enough to do the Q&A. Me and the sweater are going to be watching next week's Raw and getting Grand Theft Auto 5 because that's going to be cool. And so we're going to do the Q&A that night. So ask questions. You got a week to ask questions. So in this comment section, via Twitter, personal message, whatever, add your questions for the Q&A, whatever is cool. So we have room for as many as 10 more questions, so add an extra question or two, and we will surely answer it next week for the September Q&A. That video will go up. That's the 16th, so that would be the 21st, 22nd when the Q&A will go up. That weekend. So, thanks again for watching, everybody. I appreciate it, and stay tuned for the Impact View, Night of Champions predictions, and review coming this weekend, and of course, Q&A and the normal Raw review next week. So, thanks as always for watching, and peace out. Have a nice night.